It's your resident beauty nerd here, Michelle of Lab Muffin Beauty Science, and today we're talking about anecdotal evidence. It sounds sort of abstract, but it's really important to understand because it sort of explains why my channel exists, why science is important when it comes to figuring out what actually works for beauty products and for other things in life as well, like medical treatments and nutrition and supplements. If you like videos about the science behind beauty products, make sure you click the thumbs up, subscribe to my channel, and click the notification bell so you don't miss any videos. Anecdotal evidence is when someone says that something worked for them or someone they know. Basically, it's a one-off example of something working or not working. For example, I used this cream, the next day a pimple disappeared, and so this cream must work for treating pimples. Or I took some multivitamins, then my cold got better, so that means multivitamins fix my cold. Or my grandma smoked continuously and died at 92, so cigarettes aren't that bad for your health. We see anecdotal evidence everywhere in beauty. Testimonials and reviews are all forms of anecdotal evidence. And anecdotal evidence isn't just limited to regular consumers. Expert opinions, experience, and case reports are often forms of anecdotal evidence as well. Medical professionals, scientists, and beauty professionals all use and misuse anecdotal evidence. It's simply part of being human. All human beings have evolved to naturally be subjective and prone to biases, distortions in our thinking that stop us from being purely objective and rational machines. These biases actually helped us survive through the ages, but unfortunately, they don't help us as much in the modern world. Anecdotal evidence can be very useful in some situations. If you're going for a beauty treatment, you probably want an experienced therapist rather than a brand new one. But the problem with anecdotal evidence is, while it's sometimes really useful, it isn't reliable. And we as humans have a bias to give it far more weight than it deserves. Anecdotes aren't good enough evidence for saying a particular treatment led to a particular outcome. And if anecdotal evidence disagrees with good scientific studies, and there's no plausible explanation for how a particular treatment might work, we should go with what the science says. Anecdotal evidence can be incredibly convincing. It's a lot easier to believe someone's heartfelt story than it is to try to understand faceless, complicated, and often scarily technical scientific data, even if there are many someones behind that data. This is part of the reason why documentaries are so compelling, and why a lot of people who are pushing pseudoscience choose to use documentaries to present their case. And our love of personal stories was great for human survival. If you avoided all red berries because one person died from eating them, you end up living a lot longer and passing on your genes, even if not all red berries are dangerous. This quick mental shortcut allowed us to stay alive most of the time. But unfortunately, these quick mental shortcuts, these cognitive biases that inform our gut feelings, they also give us a distorted view of reality. We live in a much more complex world now, and we need, and have, much better tools to work out what's going on than anecdotal evidence. I know it can feel really unnatural to ignore your gut feelings, but a lot of the time, these gut feelings and instincts evolve to help us survive under very circumstances than our modern world. Being aware of these sorts of biases that we have towards anecdotal evidence means we can compensate for it. This makes us more aware of what actually works and makes us much less vulnerable to being manipulated by dodgy marketing. Being aware of these irrationalities that we all naturally have means we can make better decisions about what to do and what to buy. So let's go through some of the problems with anecdotal evidence. I'll be focusing on the ones that are more relevant to beauty products. Some of these issues have fancy technical names, so I'll put the names of them on the screen as I'm explaining them. One of the biggest problems with anecdotal evidence is that things get better on their own a lot of the time. Back to the pimple example. As most of us have probably experienced, pimples tend to get better on their own in about a week. And if you're anything like me, you probably won't bother doing anything about it until about 3 days in when it's at its ripest. So there I am putting cream on a single pimple, and it clears up about 3 days later. To me, it looks like it works. But maybe in a different timeline, I used a light pen instead, and the pimple cleared up, so it looks like the light pen worked. Or in a third timeline, I used a pimple patch, and that looked like it worked. But all along, if I just left it alone, it would have cleared up as well. And so really, none of them worked. Or maybe say I used the pimple cream, and my pimple went away faster than normal, and so it looked like it worked. But that week I also used a new cleanser, and applied some exfoliant, and went on a health kick and ate a whole bunch of vegetables. Any of these could have helped the pimple go away faster, but I only linked the pimple cream to the pimple in my mind because that's what I expected to work. Even worse, a lot of the time we forget about longer lasting treatments, and we only remember the last thing we used. I might have even started on the contraceptive pill, which takes a while to start working to reduce pimples. Then I used the pimple cream, and then the hormones kicked in and made the pimple go away faster than normal, but I think it's just the cream. These are all examples of how one thing happening doesn't mean that it caused the next thing. Just because I used the pimple cream and the pimple went away, doesn't mean that the pimple cream worked. Another issue is that humans just aren't great at observing things. I'm sure you've all had the experience where you and a friend can't agree on something really mundane, like what colour shirt someone was wearing at a party, or whether McDonald's cheeseburgers are actually getting smaller. One researcher actually developed a method that could make one third of people believe that a made-up event happened in their childhood. And not only did they believe it, they would even tack on extra details when they talked about this event to someone else. We're really good at filling gaps in our memory with random stuff, and tricking ourselves into believing things. With a pimple, unless you've been really carefully measuring it every day, you can easily trick yourself into thinking it's getting bigger or smaller, or it's going lighter or redder. If you spent a lot of money on the pimple cream and you really want it to work, you might even subconsciously trick yourself into believing that you can see a change, forgetting all the times that you used it and it didn't work. This is an example of confirmation bias or wishful thinking. And this effect can be bigger for more expensive products. It's called post-purchase rationalization, where you don't want to believe that you've wasted your money on something that didn't work. As I've talked about in my ebook, The Lab Muffin Guide to Basic Skincare, there are a few ways that you can try to make your observations as objective as possible, so things like photos and skin diaries. But while these can help you trick yourself less, it still isn't foolproof. So, ideally, how could we tell if a pimple cream really helps clear up pimples? What we have to do is set up a fair test, so we can specifically compare the pimple cream with no cream at all. We'd make sure that everything else stayed the same. For example, if you had two identical pimples on either side of your face, then everything you ate should affect both pimples equally. You could also make sure that you used every other skincare product equally on both sides of your face, or stopped every other product altogether. This is called controlling the variables. If the pimple cream worked, we'd also want to make sure it wasn't a one-off fluke, where the lighting made the pimple look smaller, or the pimple was a less severe pimple than normal, or the person scratched one pimple in their sleep, but not the other. Instead of just trying the pimple cream on one pimple, we could try the pimple cream on lots and lots of pimples, and then get rid of the one-off fluke results. If we wanted to test whether a specific ingredient worked for pimples, we could even make two creams, one with the ingredient and one without, and test the two creams against each other. To make sure the people recording the results aren't biased, we could label the creams A and B and not tell them which one was which. And that's pretty much what science does. It sets up fair tests that get rid of as much human subjectivity and bias as possible. So hopefully that gives you a better idea of why scientific evidence is better than anecdotal evidence. If science says one thing, but anecdotes say another, you should go with what the science says. But one of the big issues with skincare is that there's just not that many high-quality scientific studies around. The best ones are for prescription products, or for more serious skin conditions like rosacea. A lot of studies aren't fair tests, or they test only one specific product that's too different from a product you're using to draw any convincing comparisons. Or maybe they just didn't test enough people to say much one way or another. So if we don't have a lot of science to guide us, that's where personal experience and reviews become much more valuable, because it's the best we have. But given how subjective and prone to biases this anecdotal evidence is, there are a few things we should keep in mind so that we aren't misled. Reviews can be a fantastic resource for finding products that work well for you. But make sure you don't believe every review you read. As well as all of the problems with anecdotal evidence that I mentioned before, there are a few extra things to keep in mind with reviews. Many companies post fake reviews of their products. They might pay someone to churn out tons of positive reviews and post them online under fake profiles. Even if they aren't fake, reviews can also be incentivized. If a company gives out free samples or pays someone to review their products, this conflict of interest can mean that the review is more favourable than it might otherwise be. But at the same time, just because someone was paid or received free product, it doesn't mean that that's the only reason why a review is positive. And even if someone is reviewing a product that they bought themselves, it doesn't mean that it'll be completely objective. There are issues I mentioned before, like confirmation bias, where someone sees a change because they're expecting a change, and post-purchase rationalization, especially if it's an expensive product. There are also issues if you're looking at multiple reviews. You might see a lot of very good reviews or very bad reviews, and that's because humans are kind of lazy. Unless something works really well or really badly, we're not likely to go to the trouble of writing a review. We can't get a good idea of how likely it is we'll get a good result, how representative these reviews are. If we see 10 rave reviews, we can't easily tell if it's a niche product where only 10 people tried it and they all loved it, or a mediocre but popular product where thousands of people tried it, but it only worked well for 10 people. Very few people update their reviews, so we don't know if the product continued to work well for someone or if they changed their mind after trying it for longer. Humans are also better at remembering recent things more clearly. Products with immediate results will probably get more positive reviews than a product that works better but takes a longer time to start working. If you've ever read skincare reviews, you'll know that different people can have very different experiences with the same product. In scientific studies, the people they tried a product on are usually described very specifically. You can work out how close you are to the sorts of people they tried the product on. But in reviews, you usually know very little about the reviewer. So where does this leave us as beauty consumers? This is where I talk about what I personally think is a sensible approach. You might disagree, and that is perfectly valid. Your best bet for products that will work for you are those that have enough scientific evidence to back up its effectiveness, but also have a large number of reasonably objective, positive reviews from people in a similar situation as you. If there isn't any scientific evidence for that exact product, then you want there to be some evidence for its active ingredients. If you don't have that, then you want a plausible mechanism, a scientifically sound explanation for why it could possibly work, and no compelling scientific reason that it wouldn't work. If anecdotal evidence disagrees with the scientific evidence, then you should go with what the scientific evidence says. The higher the risk, both health-wise and in terms of budget, the stronger that scientific evidence should be. Anecdotal evidence is still useful in helping us decide which products to try, as long as we keep in mind the limitations and don't treat it as proof of something working. I hope you enjoyed this video. It's a little bit different. It's more about why we care about science rather than the science behind a particular product. So please let me know what you think in the comments. If you like videos on the science behind beauty products, click the thumbs up and you can subscribe to my channel. You can also find me on my blog labmuffin.com and on Instagram under labmuffinbeautyscience.